Academy game sent me Tudor, so let's get it to the table. In Tudor, you play as a lord serving in the House of Tudor in the court of King Henry VIII. You will place members of your family in the positions of influence to gain prestige. Whatever you do in the game, you'll need to survive the intrigues of the court and climb the ranks of the Tudor court to win the game. At the beginning of the game, you will each have a player screen that includes a hand. Each player will take turns selecting their starting rings to place on one of the fingers of the player screen. At this point, you'll want to select two different colored rings that match faction tokens that are on the bottommost spaces of the throne room columns. When deciding where to place your rings, you'll want to look at the player screen and see what actions you can enhance by putting certain rings on certain fingers. For example, if you have placed your rings on the fourth and fifth fingers, you will enhance the B action. But if you were to put them on the first and fifth fingers, you can enhance the F action. You will also take faction cards that match the same color as rings that you chose. Players will be sending their workers to the throne room to work their way up the ranks of the royal court. When you make it to the top, then you will hold the top office. When occupying a top office, you will take a new privilege ring and place it on your player screen. Remember to position your rings in a way that grants you enhanced actions for your workers to perform. If another player makes it to the top while your worker is on top, they will kick you out and take one of your rings. To move through the throne room, you will play a faction card matching the color of the faction token occupying the space, or you can move onto it if you have the matching color ring on the player screen. As you move spaces, you will pick up faction tokens as well as many influence or intrigue tokens located on the space that you end on. All influence and intrigue tokens can be used to perform bonus actions during the game, or will be exchanged for prestige at the end of the game. Each round, players will be placing their workers on different assignment benches outside the three different audience chambers. The meeples will enter the chambers in the order that they were placed and occupy the chairs on the left side of the table. At times when there are too many meeples, the new ones will push the old ones out, causing all seats to always be filled. Each player will then take their lord meeple and place it in an open chair on the right side of the table. If there is at least one of the lords present in the audience chamber, then all the player meeples in that chamber can perform one of the chamber's two unique actions. The lords are able to perform both of the actions in the chamber that they are located in. These actions will help players get influence cards, place new meeples from their supply into the throne room, move their meeples already in the throne room, and other actions that will help you manipulate the royal court. The player with the most prestige at the end of the game wins. The game is played over many rounds, which consists of five phases. Each round is represented by one of King Henry's wives pictured on the board. You will use the frame to keep track of rounds. Depending on your blue scenario card, the number of rounds might be different each time that you play. There's a recommended scenario for the first time you play, but besides then, you will randomly choose a red and green scorecard and a blue scenario card. These cards will include ways to score prestige points at the end of the game, what bonus actions that you can take by using your influence or intrigue tokens, and how many meeples that you will be assigning in the first and following rounds, and also how many rounds there are in the scenario based on the player count. Phase 1 is the chamber assignment. You will take some of your meeples depending on what the blue scenario card says, and you will take turns placing them on the benches of your choice. Phase 2 is chamber entry. The doors open in the audience chambers and the meeples will enter the chamber maintaining their assigned order. The top meeple will take the topmost seat and so on. The number of chairs available depends on the number of players in the game. If there are no chairs available, all meeples already in chairs will be pushed upwards to make room at the bottom. Any meeples pushed off the top of the chair is returned to the player's supply. Phase 3 is lord placement. In player order, players will play their lord onto one of the lord chairs located on the right side of the chamber table. Up to two lords can be placed on the same table. When a lord is present in a chamber, it allows all meeples present in that chamber to perform actions. If the chamber has no lord present at the end of this phase, move all meeples in that chamber to the empty space behind their chair to indicate that they may not perform any action this round. Phase 4 is audience chamber actions. In player order, players will activate one of their meeples or lord that hasn't performed its action this round. Players will go around until there is no more meeples or lords to activate. Once a figure is activated, it is moved behind its chair to show that they have done their action this round. Whenever a player takes the office that you previously held, they will take a ring from your screen. Now, both players can rearrange their rings since rings have been gained and lost for those players. The new meeple will stay in office until disgraced by another player, and this meeple will never be moved by any actions. Bonus actions can be played anytime and are played in addition to and separate from any lord or meeple actions, and these are listed on the sides of the player screen. Also remember your scenario card bonus actions. The card will specify bonus actions available in each game that can be performed by using influence and intrigue tokens. The player screen lists each action A through F with the highlighted fingers you need to have rings on to gain the enhancement bonus. It's also important to understand that you can only rearrange the rings on your player screen when a ring is gained or a current ring is lost. Phase 5 is the end of round phase, and the lords are removed from the chambers, the meeples are placed back in their chairs, end of round prestige is totaled and added to the track, the round marker is moved to the next portrait, and lastly, the new start player is the next player clockwise. If this is the last round, the game is over, and the in-game prestige points specified by the scoring cards are totaled and added to each player's score on the prestige track. Each player adds their remaining influence and intrigue tokens and faction cards. The player with the most will be awarded 5 points, and depending on player count, second and third place will score points as well. The player with the most prestige is the winner, and all other players will address the winner as Your Majesty until the next game. The game is quick and fun, where you need to plan precisely when to take office because someone else can come from right underneath you and take it away. The rings are very cool to put on your player screen and change them around. They're plastic with a sticker on the front, but they definitely get the job done. The game is pretty easy to teach. The player screen really helps you to know what the rings can do for you. After checking out all the choices for all the actions you can do, once you take an action, you will remember them and not need to revisit the rulebook to verify what each chamber does. Again, this is Tudor from Academy Games. If you like what you see, then go buy it.